So most likely, the phase one site assessment that you'll be conducting out in the field will be on a property called a brownfield. Remember that brownfields were an unintended consequence of the Superfund legislation because people were afraid to purchase old industrial and commercial sites because they didn't want to be held liable for the cleanup costs of those sites. So let's talk about what a brownfield is. A brownfield is an existing property in which the expansion, redevelopment, or reuse of that property is complicated by the presence or potential presence of contamination. Because brownfields kind of cropped up as a result of Superfund, in 1995, EPA created a brownfields program to promote the redevelopment of brownfields and to encourage developers to use old industrial sites instead of purchasing greenfields for their development projects. In 2002, the Small Business Liability Relief and Brownfields Revitalization Act was passed as well, and it amended Superfund to provide funds to assess and clean up brownfields. And it clarified some of those liability requirements of CERCLA to encourage people to redevelop on brownfields. It also provided funds to enhance state and tribal brownfield redevelopment efforts. So, brownfield redevelopment is promoted through grants and loans. And the brownfield redevelopment process is incredibly complicated. There are a lot of different people that are going to be involved in the brownfield redevelopment process, including real estate agents, company owners, regulators, environmental engineering firms, and developers. I have two great videos here that I want you to pause this video and watch because these are amazing videos about brownfields right in our community. So this first link here is a direct link to a video about Delaware's brownfield program. And then here, this is an amazing video talking about the redevelopment of the riverfront. I want you to watch that 20-year video because you're going to learn so much about the riverfront and how far we've come since the brownfield redevelopment project started there, way back in the early 19 in the mid-1990s. So please take a moment to watch those videos. You're going to love it. It's fascinating. All right, welcome back. So now that you've seen the amazing things that brownfield redevelopment can do, let's talk about the process. And first, let's talk about some of the challenges associated with the process. So there are definitely environmental liability concerns. People are very afraid of how much it's going to cost if contamination is found on the brownfield. There also may be financial barriers. The cost of the environmental cleanup, if the contamination is extensive, can be so significant, it can be higher than the actual value of the property, which is not going to want people to, it's not going to encourage people to invest in that property. Cleanups can take a really long time. So if developers want things to move quickly, that can be a hindrance to the process. And if you have a specific plan for a property, that plan may not fit with the remediation strategy. So, for example, if you're capping a site, but your plan is to dig a deep basement on the site for whatever structure you're building, that's not going to work. That could be a significant problem. So, you have to make sure that your plan for the site and the cleanup plan can work together to give you the best potential outcome for the site. So, as I said before, there's all sorts of people that are going to be involved in the brownfield redevelopment process. They all have different roles and they all have different goals. So, the brownfield redevelopment process, as you can see, can be really complicated because you want all of these people working together to achieve the ultimate goal, which is a high-quality redevelopment of the property that eliminates, the risk of exposure to contamination. So, we can break this brownfield cleanup process down into four steps: pre-development, securing the deal, cleanup and development, and property management. So, let's talk about each one of those in a little bit more detail. So, in pre-development, that's when you are figuring out what property you want to use, what your goal for the development would be. You want to see if you want to conduct site assessments to try to get a handle on what types of contamination are there. And you want to come up with how you're going to finance this project. So how are you going to pay for it? So this is all that background research that you have to do before you can actually start designing and redeveloping the site. Once you come up with your plan for the site, you need to secure the deal. So you need to negotiate the contract for purchasing the property, for remediation. You need to come up with financing. You need to figure out how much remediation is going to cost and actually purchase the property. So once the property is purchased, then you can get into cleanup and development. So you got to get all of your permits lined up before you can start cleaning up. So that's critically important. The permitting process can take some time. So you want to make sure that you build adequate permitting time into your project timeline. Once you have all the appropriate permits and approvals in place, then you can go forward with cleanup. Cleanup is going to be complete when a no further action letter is issued. So basically, the state or federal agency, whoever's overseeing this brownfield, is going to issue a letter saying this property is now clean and you can develop it and occupy it. It's best if you can try to integrate your cleanup and your construction. This will help you save time and money. So for example, your parking lot could potentially be a soil cap as well. So you want to try to combine things as best as you can to have the best possible outcome. So you'll clean the site up, you'll build the structures on your site, and then you can open your site and people can start inhabiting it. You can get the C2O, the certificate of occupancy for the site. But you're not done yet because brownfield properties need very special property management and maintenance. So all of those remediation strategies that have been implemented on the site need to be maintained. So property management means that you need to make sure that your site is being cared for in a way that is going to ensure that those remediation strategies aren't going to break down and re-release those contaminants back into the environment. So there may be ongoing reports and monitoring that you need to do on the site. There could be deed restrictions that say that you can't dig on the site and other things like that to ensure that into the future, those remediation strategies are still going to be in effect. So how do you get people on board and how can you pay for this? There are a few different redevelopment scenarios. The first is quite rare. This is private redevelopment. This is when the developer is going to take responsibility for the entire redevelopment process. They may receive some limited funds to help pay for it, but for the most part, they're going to take care of everything from start to finish. You also can have a public-private redevelopment where there's an agreement between a public sector entity and a private sector entity. A lot of the remediation that we see in Delaware is done through DENREC's voluntary cleanup program, and that is a public-private redevelopment strategy where DENREC is working with developers to come up with a remediation strategy and to develop the site. The developers can also be provided grants and loans that will help defray the costs of the environmental cleanup. You may also have public-led redevelopment where the entire cleanup itself is taking place through a government agency. So their government agency is responsible for assessing the site, coming up with a remediation strategy, paying for that, financing that, and developing the site. So there are a lot of different redevelopment scenarios, but the one you'll most likely see most often is the public-private redevelopment. So this is a picture of what the riverfront in Delaware looked like in about 1995 or 1996. And here's a picture today of the parking lot right in front of Frawley Stadium. So as you can see, this has made a huge change in the lives of people who live in Delaware. So if you haven't watched that video yet about the Riverfront Redevelopment Corporation, please go ahead and do it right now. I think you'll really love seeing how brownfield redevelopment makes all of our lives better.